Who's it going to be then? That leaves us with 5 backbenchers, 2 industrialists, and Prescott.
And yourself. Sounds like a field for the Grand National.
And not one of them will make as good a Minister of State as old Caswell.
It's a bit late for that. He's dead. Besides, half these deadbeats will never make the course, and the rest will get nobbled.
Yes, in with the dope tests, I say.
What do you mean by that, Lincoln?
Well, for a start, you can rule out the 2 businessmen. Frame's had enough of commerce, so you can be sure he doesn't want to be Minister of State in our department. He's gone religious. He wants the Race Relations Board. It's guilt. A greedy bastard made a fortune out of arms for Nigeria.
And Dawson?
Megalomania.
Isn't that an asset for a minister?
Not now he's taken to screaming.
Screaming?
And twitching.
Twitching?
And kicking over tables.
You better take up fiction, Lincoln.
I'm telling you, last Monday he tipped over a table at La Belle Lane just because they'd run out of chocolate mousse. Then he made his driver go so fast they hit 2 taxis and a commissionaire in the West End.
Go on saying things like this about people, Lincoln. You find yourself up for slander.
Every word's true. Clearly twitching Dawson is out. We've had enough ministers in this country with big lungs, sharp tempers and outsized thirsts. No, Dawson doesn't look like a Minister of State.
Nor you, a Foreign Office civil servant. Though I like the way you're letting speak out, instead of wrapping everything up you say, like so much diplomatic fish and chips.
Oh, thank you, Ambassador.
All right. Now you've demolished the prospects of our 2 leading tycoons. Perhaps you have some ideas about our other candidates.
You can rule out all those 5 MPs tipped by the pundits this morning.
Mrs. Lovell, MP?
Bunty's a pusher. She has talent, she's tough. She has 1 drawback.
Go on.
She's a woman.
Well, I hardly think that needs stating, considering her statistics.
Which she plays on. Can you imagine the tizzy she'd cause if she gave Sir Jayston Fowler the come on?
Our Deputy Undersecretary wouldn't know the difference between a woman and a bound copy of Hansard. No. I want Mrs. Lovell as our next minister.
Oh, no.
What the hell do you mean by that?
Well, John, I know she's a sexpot, probably the hottest politician since Eva Peron. It's not like you to let a woman come between you and your work.
She's the only one of those that I can control.
Don't forget you're in the race yourself.
Mm.
Oh, very shrewd. You push Mrs. Lovell so that Prescott, our temporary minister, doesn't become permanent. Then, after a decent interval, you leave Mrs. Lovell in the ditch.
Oh, sounds like quite a damp romp.
Decent intervals are for civil servants like you, Lincoln. No. I want the job filled permanently by Mrs. Lovell.
And make you second favorite while...
Second?
Second.
Let's get this straight. I never join any political party. Certainly not for however brief and dazzling power in government. I have to remain independent.
Back to industry one day?
One day.
The big neutral. The untainted political virgin?
Lincoln, I do know a good analyst.
What do you mean, Lincoln? Are you thinking of joining me out there in the wilderness one day? If you do, consult me first. Out there, they spill real blood, not red ink.
Doesn't it bother you that whoever gets the job might get you out and appoint a new ambassador?
Prescott.
No, Prescott's got his own department, and that's given him an ulcer. He's only a tick-over appointment.
Which leaves us with my Mrs. Lovell.
No, someone quite else. Someone pacing himself from the rear like a quality miler.
Go on, Lincoln. Who is this Olympian?
Garfield Kane, MP.
Who?
Garfield Kane, Mr. Instant Success himself. From deprived child to industrial consultant and member of parliament in a few giant strides. A francophile, a socialite, and a bit of a lad with the women.
Yes, well, let's see what Who's Who has to say about him, shall we?
Very little, so far. He's at this moment at Le Gourmet Français. Best French chef in London, of course. Lunching. With your wife.
I don't believe you.
Oh, that's true. And there was the British minister, an ex-trades union official, at this very special diplomatic luncheon at the Elysee Palace. And when the escargot was served, he just sat there like this, with his fork vertical, like Britannia on a halfpenny.
Couldn't stand the sight of snails?
Loved him. He was waiting for the salt and vinegar.
Well, if he wanted salt and vinegar so much, they should have let him have it.
The Elysee Palace?
Any palace.
A lady after my own heart.
I wouldn't bank on that, Mr. Kane.
Now, don't tell me you didn't check on me before accepting my invitation to lunch.
Should I have?
Well, it's customary in diplomatic circles before accepting anyone's invitation to do a little vetting.
What do you do before inviting someone for dinner?
Now, dinners are for people who know each other. In a month or less, I'll ask you to dinner. Don't appreciate my sense of humour.
Noticed any, only your extraordinary snobbery.
I can see you're new to diplomacy, Lady Wilder.
After all, you're no better than a man who eats oysters with a spoon, are you?
Never said anything about oysters.
Snails,
sir. Or what about a spoon? Did you know, for example, you can eat frog's legs with chopsticks?
Where?
Peking. Garfield Kane? Oh, yes, Maggie, would you? But not before 4:30. No, I'm enjoying myself too much. Bye, Maggie. Bye.
John used to take phone calls in restaurants.
Oh, there's no gimmick, I assure you.
I should have thought you'd have known that head waiters should serve food, not GPO lines.
Mm, tastes better.
Oh, thank you. I'm amazed you didn't just casually mention some deal worth millions of dollars, or rather hundreds of millions of francs.
Not even Ben's, I'm afraid. Some of my constituents want to see me. They're being pushed around.
Oh, but I dare say you'll be able to knock up some useful publicity out of it.
I'll knock a few heads together. Don't make me out a total cynic. I'm only 50% one, or at the most 60. And you must try the treacle tart.
Treacle tart, français.
Anglais, français. I taught the chef how to do it. Treacle tart, that is. René, de treacle tart. It's a British gourmet's contribution to the Entente Cordiale.
Don't you mean discordial?
Well, some of us have to keep on trying. It's sometimes a bit overfacing, but it does have its own rewards.
In sterling and francs.
You don't like politicians, do you? Or is it just this one?
The age of virtuous politics is past.
And we are deep in that of cold pretense. But isn't your husband a politician now?
John is ambassador for special situations and trade. He wouldn't join your party if you gave him the powers of Cromwell.
Oh, hasn't he caught the Oliver C virus? Spreading worse than Hong Kong flu.
I didn't come here to talk about my husband.
No, no. You're here because I want you to serve on a charity committee.
Which I trust exists.
Oh, yes. But now you are here, I just want your husband to know that if Prescott is confirmed in the job as Minister of State, Wilder will be out inside a month.
Oh, he'll bounce back. Higher every time.
You don't mind, then?
Why are you telling me this and not John?
Well, I don't know him.
You don't know me, Mr. Kane.
No, he'd mistake my motives.
I think you're scared of him.
Well, I want to work with him, not against him.
Work with him?
As his minister.
I don't think I'll stay for your treacle tart, Mr. Kane. I think it's time you learnt not to invite a lady, even one who hasn't had you vetted, to lunch under false pretenses.
No, no, please, there's no false pretenses. Just one thing I want your husband to know, and then... Prescott has plans to combine the job of ministers with that of your husband's. He fancies VIP trips to faraway places, pulling off vast deals a la Sir John Wilder, wherever he goes. Natural fact, he's never done a deal in his life, not even for peanuts. It's all a substitute for sex.
So, no charity committee?
Oh, yes. I want you to serve on the committee of something I run to raise money for an orphanage. No, it's my old school. We even... You'd never believe this. We even have a tie.
What do you mean he's not back yet? He's supposed to be collecting my wife. All right. Tell him to call me as soon as he gets back. He's getting too independent.
Doing the rounds of his business chums in your roles. I blame you, John. He wasn't ambitious before he worked for you.
The day we met, he told me he aimed to be an ambassador before he was 45. That's ambition. Oh.
Now he wants to make money, pots of it, before he's 35.
And he will do. Anybody who can wander off in my rolls and keep it all afternoon is well on the way.
Not to mention your wife. When I borrowed your rolls once for an hour, John, you used a far less complimentary word than ambitious.
Well, try Bunty Lovell again. Either she didn't get the message, Or she takes lunch to be a half-day feast. And make sure that the surprise visit of the Eastern European delegation doesn't upset my meeting with the Foreign Secretary. I'll be in the study.
John, our man for all seasons, Lincoln Dowling, says you're wasting your time lobbying the Foreign Secretary for the job.
Does he?
I realize that my tenancy here as minister is for the moment temporary, but if I should stay, you, Sir Jayston, as civil service head of the department, would find your staff and powers increased. I've been looking at your memos and been disturbed to see so many of your excellent ideas just not acted upon.
Oh, thank you, Minister.
For you, darling, I have the highest regard. I should like to see you groomed as the next roving ambassador.
A personnel would never wear it at my age. It's supposed to be bad for the morale of the ones left behind.
Well, even they must learn the need to change. I'm all for having ambassadors in their 30s and 40s, instead of keeping them down till their skin dries up. Anyway, that's all I want to say. Thank you, gentlemen.
Prescott's quite definitely not our man, Lincoln.
Dried up before his time.
I'm glad you agree. It's so rarely these days you do. Still, I can see what he's up to. He would amalgamate his own department with ours and import his own hierarchy.
Which would be goodbye to you.
And you, for all your urge to try new pastures, might find yourself menially tied to the old. Running errands would be quite a come down from riding around all the afternoon in Wilder's roles.
I'm running nobody's errands, either now or in the future.
So when do you leave us for the big grab outside?
Well, not before everyone's snatched all the plums here.
Still, I should deliberate with care, Lincoln, before you step into the undergrowth.
You make business sound like some primitive corner of the Matto Grosso.
Well, isn't it? I'm not lucky enough to have a son. But I'd never let my nephews entertain business as a career.
Did your nephews wear pinstripe nappies?
That'll do, darling.
Yes, Sir Jason.
And while you remain here, you'd do well to help us make sure that our temporary minister Prescott presently departs.
I didn't know you were a John Wilder man.
He's the last person I'd want at that desk.
Don't tell me you're carrying on with Mrs. Bunty Lovell, MP.
Don't be facetious, Lincoln.
Oh, I don't know. A quick tumble off your high horse into Bunty's bed might bring the colour to your cheeks.
Lincoln, I will not endure rudeness from a raw apprentice.
Yesterday you were going on about my great qualities when you wanted my backing against Wilder.
Don't forget you may yet want a favourable annual report from me should your big business ideas crumble. You can still help us to ensure that we, as officials, get the minister we want.
And who's that?
The best of a bad lot. Garfield Kane.
I thought that was the lyric I'd hear.
And where the hell have you been?
Learning to eat frog's legs with chopsticks.
And did you?
Did I what?
That was a straightforward question.
And I'll give you the answer in French, if you'll allow me a moment to acclimatize. Oh, thank you, Dom. That's two gentlemen I've met today.
Since when has Darling been a gentleman?
Poor Lincoln, you do have it in for him.
He was sent to collect you.
And this piece of baggage needed no collecting. Oh, Dom, you do it, will you? Did you know, either of you, that the cultural renaissance in Europe is in full swing?
I find the news deeply moving.
I know more about Paris, France, from this one afternoon than if you had been British ambassador for a whole year at the Quai d'Orsay.
Well, never mind about Paris, France. All that matters is what you've been saying in London, England, at lunch today, which appears to have been lavish.
Sophisticated.
Whatever. Don, get a damn pair of scissors or leave it.
Oh, no, Don, don't leave it. No, it should be opened in the interest of the spread of cultural knowledge. And scissors, is it dangerous? Do you know either of you? Why, the girl with the best legs in Paris wears a maxi skirt.
Something to do with French culture?
No. Don?
No? Oh, no idea, really. Unless her father's a cloth manufacturer.
Hmm?
Well, I mean, if he makes cloth, this is in his interest to make maxi skirts. He uses more cloth.
Oh, for God's sake, Pamela!
Shall I tell you?
In as few words as possible.
You see,
When she was very young in Marseille, she made a mistake. She joined the French Navy, the French Wrens, of course.
One would hardly have expected her to be in the Marines.
And, she had her legs tattooed.
For God's sake, don't open that parcel. Give it to me.
Do you know, the man who painted that was only 23 years old.
I should have thought he'd been under 14.
In another 30 years, he'll be as famous as Picasso is now.
In another 30 years, if he goes on doing daubs like that, he'll drive the world mad.
Well, I think it's very attractive, Pamela.
And so do I.
What's it supposed to be?
Be? It's not supposed to be anything. It exists in its own right. Freddy, you are a philistine, John.
I only hope you didn't buy it.
It was a gift.
Well, whoever gave you that wasn't generous. He was a practical joker.
Whoever gave me that is 6'1", self-made, fascinating, and a great European who cares about the Entente Concordiale.
Pamela, should I go and make you a nice cup of tea?
Or strong black coffee?
Yes, John. Yes, if you make it. If you personally, with your own hands, make it. Without sugar.
He must be quite a fella.
Who?
Whoever took you to lunch.
He has style.
And a penchant for dustbin art.
Not to mention a penthouse with a view right over Shepherd's Bush.
Who wants a view over Shepherd's Bush?
I liked it.
What else has he got there besides 10th-rate art? Bound copies of Playboy? Mirrors?
Yes? Oh, just a minute. It's Bunty Lovell for you, John.
Hello, Mrs. Lovell. I'm glad you called, yes. Can we meet tomorrow? In my office, yes. Yes, that would be ideal. Yes, thank you very much. Goodbye.
Mrs. Lovell.
MP. With a majority of 4,000 odd.
Well, I don't care about her odd majority. How old is she?
About as old as Garfield Kane.
Ah, now there's a man to watch, John. A man to watch damn closely.
Get a bottle of brandy, Dom.
Brandy?
Yes, brandy. You make it sound like vaccine.
A bottle or three glasses?
Didn't know that Don had joined the Band of Hope, did you? A bottle and three glasses.
John, it's 3:30 in the afternoon. Quite sure you're not doing this to get your own back.
What's that all about?
Oh, Pamela had a jolly afternoon out at lunch with Garfield Kane.
Oh, yes, I know. Bisto kid to bon vivant, that one.
Well, it's not a bad image.
Oh, no. He has one of the best publicity agents in town. To you, John, those plans must look like love letters.
So the old Simon, it certainly takes me back.
Think you'd ever go back to making aeroplanes?
Not until I have a European setup strong enough to smash in on the Americans.
Yes. I think that's what you've missed, John, all these years. The challenge of keeping 20,000 people in work.
Oh, she's a beauty, isn't she?
Yep. Every tycoon will want one for his firm.
And for his girlfriend. What's the market potential?
Over the next 7 years, around 4,000. Could be the biggest seller since the Viscount. But I confess you have me puzzled, John. We have the Germans all but hooked on a co-production deal. And you of all people want to bring the French in. You were never much of a froggy lover when I worked, under you?
All I'm saying, Simon, is we ought to let the French have a sniff of it. And they'll follow their big noses right in, albeit with a show of Gallic grandeur. Then the Germans will close without any further delay.
You sure that's all, John? No more to it?
What else could there be?
So, we use the French as bait to encourager les autres.
And I take care of any anti-German political prejudice on our side. Bring it up, Simon. It's French, and naturally very old.
I shall have to go easy. I'm due at the German embassy after this.
I wish you'd given you schnapps. Have another one, Simon.
Well, I will have just one more. It's not quite the way to dispose of good brandy. Still, work before aesthetics. Mm. Shall I leave those with you, John?
Yes. I like to look at them.
Yes. Well, goodbye then.
Goodbye, Simon.
Goodbye, Simon.
Oh, thanks very much. Bye.
Doc, huh? Get hold of Garfield Kane. Tell him I want to see him.
Now, you mean?
Yes, Jill?
Mrs. Lovell is here to see you, Sir John.
Oh, will you show her straight in?
Do you still want me to get hold of Kane?
Immediately.
Any more of the people's representatives you want rounded up while I'm at it?
I heard you'd introduce novel practices into Whitehall, Sir John.
Well, the only thing that's new about it is its quality. If a survey were taken of the hooch in all the offices here, you'd probably find the spirit manufacturers advertising in the Civil Service Gazette. Can I offer you one?
No, thank you. I don't imagine you invited me here for a binge.
You know why you're here. Won't you sit down?
Everyone knows that we, amongst others, are both in line for appointment of Minister of State in this department.
Well, I'm glad the appointment is not being made on looks. Mrs. Pankhurst would have had you in her frontline chorus. Are you sure you won't have a drink?
I have a dozen constituents waiting to see me in the House, some of whom want to stop Sunday licensing, and then I expect to speak in a debate.
Foreign affairs?
Pregnant au pair girls.
Oh, I'm sorry.
It's not funny.
I don't think so either. It was merely the juxtaposition.
You don't have to pretend with me, Sir John. I can see straight through you.
I assure you, I have every sympathy.
I'm talking about the appointment now.
Oh. Don't come your woman's wiles with me, Mrs. Lovell. As far as the job is concerned, you're a fella.
Fine.
Though when you were a parliamentary private secretary, I hear you had half your civil servants over the moon after you.
This cow jumps over no moons, Sir John.
I don't know about cows. You seem to have come here for a bullfight.
You've been saying that you want me to get the job because you think you can tame me.
If I said any such thing, I was very rash. I would as soon tame a fully grown tiger.
Tigress.
Tiger.
If you've invited me here in the hope of persuading me to withdraw from the candidates list, you're wasting your time. Whatever the inducements.
Inducements?
I'm told that you have a splendid talent for buying your way out of trouble. I am not buy-offable.
That's slander.
I'll fight you all the way.
You're more militant than a battalion of commandos. I understood that you were a domesticated housewife.
With a couple of kids, not to mention an aging mother-in-law and an au pair girl.
Who is not pregnant.
How can one tell?
Would it surprise you to learn that I'm not interested in becoming the new minister, only in who gets the job?
For someone who's seen the Foreign Secretary 3 times in the past 24 hours and has also been trying to see the PM, you don't sound like much of a non-starter to me.
I told the Foreign Secretary who I wanted in the job.
Not me.
I don't want Prescott or any bloated politician.
I'm one.
Unbloated and a woman.
Oh, Come, Sir John. Your record doesn't show that you have very much confidence in women. You wouldn't take that woman who was such an expert in swing-wing geometry onto your board at Scott Furlong.
It was her own geometry that bothered me. 38, 24, 36. I didn't want distracted directors playing footsie under the table. Are you sure you won't have a brandy?
Yes. And to hell with the anti-Sunday licensing delegation. Though I don't want to be breathing fumes all over Mr. Speaker.
Yes, John?
Don, will you bring in the brandy? I don't want you to think this is our usual routine, or that I am trying to prejudice your chances of appointment. We shall only need two glasses, Don. Don't stand there like some wine waiter in an orgy.
No wonder the nation's on its beam ends.
Pamela, this is Mrs. Lovell, MP.
You know, I thought you were going to say that.
My wife.
Well, who comes next? Danny LaRue and the Bluebell Girls?
Pamela. Well, would you care to take a drink with us?
You know I'm on the wagon, John. Anyway, I wouldn't dream of intruding on such affairs of state. Actually, though, I was looking for Lincoln.
Don. Hmm?
Lincoln?
Lincoln Darling, my private secretary. One of the Foreign Office high flyers.
Oh, I thought so. Yes, he's certainly been flying high amongst my friends, not to mention my enemies. Question here, an inquisitive phone call there. For you.
I know all I need to know about you. If Darling has been doing any digging, you can be sure the shovel belongs to the permanent civil service here, who believe they have a right to influence the appointment of a new minister in their own interests.
I know somebody who also believes in this right, in his interests. He's been doing more lobbying in the right places than anyone.
So I think I know who you're talking about.
The professional orphan.
Garfield Kane.
Frank, if Wilder jumps the queue of loyal backbenchers, if he's made Minister of State just for signing a party card, the explosion will make student riots look like Parents' Day at Eton.
Now, don't tell me how to do my job.
I've been a member of this party as long as you have, Frank. As Chief Whip, you're custodian of its interests in this house. You know quite well what a menace Wilder is to backbench MPs who are quite reasonably looking for promotion.
Like you?
I've worked for it.
Wilder could be quite a catch for the party if you were only willing.
Willing? Since the day Caswell died, his mouth's been as wide open as a hungry shark's.
Now, don't you believe it?
He protests too much. He's never fought shy of power since the day he was born.
Suppose I were to disclose that Wilder has been discreetly sounded out.
Oh. Go on.
And said no. Loud and bloody clear.
Tactics to make sure you ask him again, more persuasively. Did you offer him a peerage?
No.
You mean not yet?
I mean no.
Well, do so, and you have your new minister.
How often have you met him, Garfield?
I know what he's made of.
But you're talking from ignorance.
And from a long experience of our party. Do you want a rebellion?
Led by you from your usual position at the rear?
You can't keep hard-working MPs sitting on the back benches like dumb waiters serving your political banquet.
You're not the only candidate, Garfield.
Prescott? Couldn't run a 10th-rate discotheque.
What I like about you is your loyalty to your colleagues.
Now listen, Frank. Part of your job as Chief Whip is to ensure that the broth of opportunity is kept stirred, not to keep jobs for established junior ministers like Prescott or the Wilders.
You're not even the only backbencher in the hunt, Garfield.
Bunty Lovell. The FO would never take a woman like that in this job, Frank, and you bloody well know it.
Hmm. I didn't ask you here about this anyway. You offered to help convince those troublesome fellow backbenchers of yours of their duty to the party.
Well now, Frank, if that's what you want, I think I can help.
Good.
If I'm warned just once more to be on my guard against Garfield Kane, I'll know you've all turned a shade of jealous green. You're not jealous? Oh, no, Lincoln.
I've no right to be, have I?
No, no, you haven't.
It's nothing to do with rights, actually. Only chromosomes.
Lincoln.
All I said was he's a crafty politician who believes in using people.
Well, John uses me, I use him. You and Don incessantly use me to influence. John Garfield was doing no more than that. Anyway, Don at least isn't crafty, he's sweet.
You left me out of that last bit.
You, Lincoln, are not nice to know. I do sometimes find you fascinating and complicated and interesting and sometimes attractive.
I'm flattered. He's going about it the wrong way, you know, if he wants to be minister.
Why on earth does nobody believe him when he says he doesn't?
Because he's been lobbying the Foreign Secretary and trying to cultivate Downing Street.
Well, who on earth else should he lobby? Mrs. Bunty Lovell? Lobbying Mrs. Bunty Lovell.
Wilder's been wasting his time. He should be cultivating the puppet master, the man who pulls all the strings as far as jobs are concerned. Government chief whip.
Have you told him?
Oh, he stopped listening to me.
So you want me to tell John? Now who's using who, Lincoln?
If Garfield Kane gets the job, I'll clear out within 24 hours. My resignation will be in before he even steps foot in the place.
But you don't even know him.
I know enough.
Lincoln, I had no idea you were sitting waiting out there in the rolls yesterday.
And if you had?
Well, I'd have introduced you to Garfield.
It wasn't Kane I wanted to talk to.
Now you're just being silly. Anyway, by all accounts, you kept the rolls all afternoon. Who did you pick up in it?
Well, if you must know, I got Goodall to keep going round and round the High Park Circle.
Whatever for?
I needed to think.
Nobody else in the back seat?
Not even a Dolly Bird.
Link, darling, you are jealous.
All I can say, Garfield, is that if you can help to persuade these half-dozen recalcitrants to hold off attacking the government for another month...
I told you, Frank, leave it to me. I know how to handle Headley and Dunhill, and without that pair of political rams, the rest are sheep who'll graze on placidly.
I hope you're right.
Absolutely right.
If you can pull this off, Garfield, we in the Parliamentary Party will be in your debt.
Oh, I know that, Frank. I know that perfectly well.
It's Sir John Wilder calling.
I'm sorry, he's not back yet. Oh, one moment, please. Sir John Wilder again. He shouldn't be terribly long. Is there any message?
Well, I've left two already. You might ask him to call.
As soon as I get hold of him. Goodbye.
What do you think he's up to, John?
He's trying to suggest that his appointment is cut and dried. A sure thing, about which he has to keep total silence till it's announced.
I suppose it is.
I don't think so. It won't be announced for a few days. Time enough for him to nibble our piece of French cheese.
Maggie, you didn't say Dufour had been on?
Just before you came in.
Where is he? Not in London?
No, in his office in Paris.
And this was all he said? Nothing more?
He said Sir John Wilder was trying to set up this co-production deal with the French for this executive jet. And you might want to intervene and help.
And this was all he said?
All that counts.
Maggie, everything Dufour says counts. There's nobody bigger in French aviation.
He also said that if he made this an excuse to come to London, would I one night do the King's Road with him?
What? God! He's 60! What about the French use for blood transfusions? All right, Maggie. Get me Dufour in Paris, and then I'll be ready to talk to our Sir John. Well, I have Headley and Dunhill dropping in around 4. So if you would like to come in just before, it would appear circumstantial and not like the carpeting it would seem if you were to discipline them in your office. Right, Frank. Bye.
Do come in, Sir John.
Thank you. Sir John. So pleased to meet you face to face at last.
We met some other way.
Well, I stood behind you once at a Lord Mayor's banquet. I was facing your wife, which I'm sure you'll agree is aesthetically preferable. Your friend Mrs. Lovell has been addressing the house for the past 10 minutes. She'll be there for quite a time yet, if I know her.
I'm surprised you're still in the building.
Well, there's a three-line whip on. As MPs, we're supposed to be trained watchdogs. I'd say chained. She's got in on the age of consent debate. Mind you, she'd parade Stark as if she thought it would help her to get the minister's chair.
I'm flattered you should come here, Sir John. I understand it's more usual for you to be called on.
I'd go anywhere, Kane. To the least significant of people. If I wanted something badly enough.
Mm. And what you want now is the Minister of State job.
What gave you that idea?
Oh, come, Wilder. I know I'm just a humble backbench MP who even has to share an office. But I know you've been lobbying like mad.
Not for me. For you. I couldn't work as ambassador under a minister whose only concern was the building of futile empires.
You mean our stopgap, Prescott?
Who, if he gets the job, intends to display his talents as a globe-trotting trade genius. I don't think he could sell jelly babies.
What about our other candidate? Westminster's answer to Bridget Bardot.
Yes, Mrs. Lovell is very attractive.
As a candidate?
As a woman. Now, can you see me working under a woman?
You could work on one. I don't see why you support me, or say you do.
Because you're so ambitious. You'd be so busy with your politics, you'd leave me to get on with my own job.
Still don't believe you, you know.
Ah, it's up to you.
But if you mean what you say, there's a way you could help. One of our aircraft firms, of which you were once managing director, has on its drawing boards an executive jet. Now, if we could get a co-production deal with the French, with whom I might say, in all modesty, I have substantial influence...
Somebody's been talking.
Oh, I know it's all hush-hush.
I must remain so.
All the same, if I knew more about the aircraft and its possibilities, I might well hasten a deal with France.
Where they don't eat frogs' legs with chopsticks.
Your wife? Have a lucky man, Wilder. And, by the way, it wasn't from her that I heard about the aircraft deal.
Oh, she knows nothing about it. And in future, if you want to talk to me, you needn't have to do it through her.
She's doing a great deal of work for my orphanage.
Well, if you think you can pull the French in, discreetly.
I'm sure I can.
Well, I see what I can do. But first, you must see the plans and specifications. I'll see they're sent over to you.
Well, thank you, Sir John.
Tyler, too. He's thrashing around, ready to take the bait. All you have to do, Don, this afternoon is dangle it to him.
I'm not with you, John.
The aircraft plan. All right, Goodall. The Foreign Office, please.
Sir John Wilder's office.
Sir John there?
Not yet, Minister.
Tell him to see me when he is.
Why did you shut the door, Miss Thomas? You shut the door.
Sir John doesn't like drafts.
He's not here.
As I've been telling the Minister for the past 2 hours.
There's no one else in the other room, is there? Well, then why shut the door?
Well, actually, Sir Jayston, I have it in mind to seduce you. You quite knock me out.
I imagine somebody knows where Sir John is.
Yes, I do.
Well, then kindly tell him I waited.
You were early. He said 4:30. It's now 4:29 and a bit.
Did you shut that door, Jayston? I begin to have my doubts about you. See that he gets it straight away. Huh. Well, Jayston, do you want Prescott slung or not?
Not the verb I'd have chosen.
To hell with the semantics, yes or no?
I should prefer someone other, in the interest of the country and the office.
Not to mention your interests. Oh, we're on the same side, Jayston.
This isn't April the 1st, Wilder.
You want Kane in.
I understood you'd prefer a woman.
Infinitely. In the right place.
Mrs. Lovell, MP.
Could you assume that my interest in Mrs. Lovell was not political, but purely immoral. If you want to give Kane a leg up in this department, there is a way open to both of us, which is, to say in the least, ironic.
No.
Prescott, in his naivety, trusts you. As temporary head of this department, he could push an Anglo-French co-production deal on a jet aircraft, the credit for which, in the end, would go to Kane.
Will you brief me in this deal? Or will Dowling?
Dowling? No, get hold of Henderson.
Yes, Sir John?
Jill, will you come in for a moment? So it's up to you, Jayston. If you want to help Kane, with your usual discretion, of course.
Right.
Your master's lady friend is still on her feet, and in good voice.
Quite a bird, Bunty.
Yes, the predatory kind. The harpy eagle. She'll get a big press in the morning, and she knows it. Now, I must say, if I were in her shoes, I'd use different tactics. I mean, if I were Mrs. Lovell, gunning for the job as Minister of State in the FO. I'd swear I'd be making the running right now.
Madame Froskova?
She's an outsized Muscovite in more senses than one. She's one of her country's top state-employed consumer goods buyers. Bunty should be cultivating her, not letting her tongue rip in the house. Still, who am I to advise my rivals, eh?
I'm not happy about your inviting all these tycoons. I mean, it's pretty obvious all you're doing is trying to squeeze cash out of them for your pet orphanage.
Blackmail isn't always black, Lincoln.
This is a pretty murky off-white.
Doesn't it warm you? Doesn't it excite you a little? The prospect of prizing open those tight, podgy fists. I can't bear men with podgy fingers. Lincoln, you haven't. Let me see. Come on, Lincoln.
That's them. It happened when I was 9. My mother used to send me to the butcher's for chops. He was a bad-tempered butcher with a red face, and I used to give him a bit of lip.
Did they prosecute him for child cruelty?
No, but the head butcher axed him.
Come on, Lincoln, open up those podgy fists. Lincoln, you're not safe to be with.
You keep saying that, and you keep seeing me. And I haven't podgy fingers.
Well, they're hardly long and elegant, are they?
Misspent youth. Too much time on the guitar.
The guitar wasn't invented when you were young. Oh, damn, and we've got so much work to do.
Well, I'm glad you're here. You've got so much work to do. So put down whatever it is you have and wrap your fingers around that glass and listen.
He can't.
If you need a social secretary so much, why don't you hire one?
He can't.
What?
Wrap his fingers round that glass. Can you, Lincoln? They won't travel that far. Oh, Mrs. Lovell, do sit down. Can I get you a drink?
Oh, thank you, yes. Vodka. I may as well get in some practice.
Get weaving on your Soviet contacts. They have a visiting VIP that it's important that Bunty should get to know. Quickly.
Madame Froskova.
Well, I'm delighted you're so on the ball.
Whose idea is this?
Why?
Only it's not a very good one.
Please, Lincoln, just do as you're told.
All right.
Great.
They're here?
They're on their way up. Mrs. Long?
Right in it. Up to here.
I told you yesterday it was a lousy idea.
But you never said that Madame Froskova was one of the female hawks behind the Czechoslovakian invasion.
You wouldn't listen.
Hell, she looks like somebody who runs a Siberian camp.
Anyway, your favorite lady MP can wave goodbye to being our minister.
Find out if Kane has got old his French aviation chums.
They flew over this morning. They'll be having cocktails with Prescott and Kane at this moment.
Well, at least something's going right. Did Prescott invite Simon Dave and the other directors from the aircraft industry?
Which Davy and co. declined.
Then you'd better get Simon Davy to give you a letter of complaint about this French interference.
It's done. I drafted it an hour ago. He came in and signed it. There's also the accompanying memo for you to sign. I can't avoid being a step or two ahead on my own initiative, but if you resent it...
Lincoln, don't be cheeky. Yes. This should do. Just see that the Foreign Secretary gets it immediately.
Right.
Prescott here. Oh, yes, yes, Foreign Secretary. Yes, at the moment. Oh, no. Yes, indeed, Foreign Secretary. You'll excuse a moment, gentlemen.
What? Excuse me.
Kane,
yeah?
I'm about to make my excuses. You can do what you like with your French friends, so long as you get them out of here in 1 minute flat.
What?
Do you know what we're doing? We're botching up a big deal with the Germans that could be signed today. Get them out of here.
Mes amis, c'est absolument nécessaire.
Well, let's see Prescott and Kane survive that.
All that can be said about that pair now is rest in peace. Prescott will be very much out. But I wouldn't be so sure about Kane.
I was just passing this way, Garfield. What in hell did you think you were up to? The Foreign Secretary's fuming.
Yes, well, I must say I've laid a few neat traps in my time, Frank. But the way Wilder baits his.
Oh, well. You can't win them all, Garfield. Mm. And I am grateful to you for straightening out our waverers. You handled Dunhill very neatly.
Yes, well, he always wanted to go with that parliamentary delegation to Hawaii.
I'm still wondering how you got Headley to toe the line.
Managed to get him a neat little sideline as political advisor to an import-export house.
Oh. Not dealing in aeroplanes, I hope.
You watch me orbit that industry at long range in future, Frank. Yes, Maggie?
You're expected at number 10, right away.
Number 10? Thank you, Maggie.
Congratulations, Minister.
You, Frank?
Even though you nearly chucked it all away.
It's Garfield, darling.
Well, I suggest that you agree whatever you have to agree with my wife about this charity thing. Then take your leave, Kane.
I'm very grateful for all you're doing, Pamela, but that isn't why I'm here, though I had to imply on the phone for security reasons that it was. Well, it might not be out of place to offer me a drink, Sir John. After all, I did come here. As your new minister, I could have well sent for you.
You? After that French fiasco?
Mere ripple on the surface of deep political water, John.
Political mud.
Well, for heaven's sake, let's toast something, even if it's only Lincoln's charity list.
Well, that isn't quite the most important thing that's happened today, but I'll drink to that. If you will.